708-6101. 707-578-6101. Or visit us on the web at www.fountaingroveinn.com.
Live across America.
I need love, love. To ease my mind.
Need some love. We need Paula Zahn on the case. She's here. Signed for a second season, I understand, also for a third season. Wow. Hello, Paula. How are you? Hello, Paula.
There she is.
Hey. Today?
How are you doing? What have you been up to?
I've been doing a little bit of reporting lately for Investigation Discovery.
You really have, and you just, I understand you just got about to start the second season, but you just got signed for a third season as well.
I know. My heart rate is up so high. I don't think I can have any coffee for the next couple of days.
That's really cool, Paula. Now, tell us, what can we check out on the show? What are we expecting to see on the show?
Well, this season, we have found some amazing stories to tell. As is the case with many crime stories, you often find out in the reporting of the story that the chief witnesses against somebody who's convicted may have recanted their story, and sometimes that information never gets to the defense attorney representing their client. So we have these cases with really fascinating legal complications and challenges, and then, you know, just character-driven stories with people you can't make up. It really is central casting. There's one story that I think will unfold the fourth week of this season, which is an amazing story about a young kid who was convicted of murder. And after his conviction, his mother obviously proclaims he's innocent, as is usually the case of most parents not wanting to believe their kid ever could have done something heinous. But in her case, she fervently believed it.
Not my mom's case. My mom's the exact opposite.
Is she?
Yeah.
You know,
I think Eric did it.
Yeah, I know. I mean, I try not to be that punitive with my children, but...
you're a great interviewer, man. When you get a hold of them, man, you don't let go.
Oh, well, thank you. But in this mother's case, I mean, it was an amazing thing because she wanted to prove that the jury pool was tainted. So she lost 50 pounds and started dressing like Aaron Brockovich, handpicked a juror that convicted her son, befriended him, and rented an apartment. This is a married woman, rented an apartment like two blocks from this guy, and then over a period of spending 40 hours with him, got him to admit he never should have been on the jury because he knew a couple of the kids who were friendly with the convicted killer.
This is real-life story. This is no joke.
Real-life story. But wait till you see pictures of this woman. You know, she wore hot pants. She did everything to seduce this guy. And tried to get him high on drugs to show that he was using drugs during the trial. So, you know, you can't make this stuff up. And these are the kinds of things that, you know, that you see in cases that make for riveting stories.
Well, now, Paul, I mean, this is amazing. I mean, number one, forgive my naivete, but I always thought that if a witness recanted, all of a sudden these wheels of justice started turning to make sure we get this problem rectified. But that's not the case.
No, it's not the case. In fact, we have had in the first two seasons, with four of our stories, situations where the testimony was recanted, not once, not twice, but more than three times. And in each one of the cases, the defense attorney was never told. And 10 years into someone's incarceration, this information comes forward, oftentimes because these guys who are sitting in prison are educating themselves about the legal system as their appeals are running out, and they are allowed to get, you know, information through the Freedom of Information Act, and they start solving their own cases.
That's amazing. Now, Paula, is it the same with, like, genetic evidence? If there's maybe a cold case, and how does that happen with the genetic evidence? I mean, if there's a cold case and maybe somehow, how do you re-stimulate that kind of case? How do you get that thing going again?
Well, it's interesting you should mention that, because in this one case that we're doing this season with it's a wrongful conviction case. He sat in prison for 27 years, 25 years into incarceration. The chief witness against him comes forward, says, "I can't live with myself any longer in the guilt." Wow. I testified in court that I overheard this guy bragging that he had murdered someone. Well, guess what? I never heard that. It was made up. I was reading it off a cue card. Now, in addition to that, the DNA evidence was seized that was never processed before. This is the quirk of fate. One of the women who was a court reporter happened to keep this T-shirt that was found at the scene of the murder and sort of had burrowed away in a safe at the local courthouse, and everybody had forgotten about it. So when this witness came forward and said, "I lied," and she said, "Oh, my God, I have this T-shirt," they tested, and they found the DNA. So What happens when you look at some of these cases that have been cold for decades, the DNA evidence wasn't routinely tested. And now, you know, the science is much better. And that's why some of these guys who've been sitting on death row for so long are able to get off, because now people are really pushing for this DNA evidence to be used.
But it's
amazing in these cases, sometimes how rape kits aren't processed for many months.
Yeah, just falling through the cracks.
Paula Zahn is on the case. It's on Investigation Discovery. Signed for a second season, now a third season. I guess you can put the down payment down on the house, is that right?
You know, you never get that cocky. You just take it a season at a time,
that's
and you're
right.
Thrilled when the audience finds you, and thrilled when the boss says, come back for another season. But, no, I'm hopeful. I mean, I have a great team that I'm working with, and everybody's working around the clock to try to find the best stories we can. So, you know, we hope this has a very long run.
Well,
the signs so far are pretty good.
Well, Paula, you've talked with dignitaries between everybody from Bill Clinton to George Bush to Jimmy Carter, Gerald Ford,
Carmichael,
all of them.
Yeah.
And now she's talking to the people. She's on the case, and it's on Investigation Discovery. I wish you much luck, and thanks for dropping by. We really appreciate it, Paula.
Thanks, Jack and Eric. It's always nice talking with the two of you.
See you guys.
You too, Paula.
Bye-bye.
Yes. Sounds
nice
good.
Nice
Paula really
she does a good job. And when she gets on somebody, okay.
She gets them.
All right.
You know, I feel bad. You know, it's really sad
to hear reporter.
These stories about these guys that have been in prison, you know, unfairly, unjustly for, you know, this guy was in there for 27 years in prison. And, I mean, I'm not going to say what kind of nefarious character he might have been, but he certainly was not the nefarious character that deserved 27 years in jail.
But with that said, most people who are in prison are exactly where they belong.
Well, I would say this, Jack, is that there's nobody, you know, accidentally sending me to prison for 27 years.
That's right, you're right.
You know, and it just kind of makes me think, well, maybe, you know, yeah, maybe you're right. Maybe these guys were kind of hanging with the wrong
there
crowd.
There are some people who, there are cases where they've almost been put to death. I mean, they've come
very
close.
Well, there's people that have been put to death.
Yep.
Yeah, unfairly.
But
the idea, though, that they weren't
convicted. They're the exception, okay? The exception.
Well, the idea is that if they weren't convicted for that crime in particular, but they really weren't the perpetrator of that crime, then they don't deserve the punishment. I mean, even if they were a bad guy, sure, they could have been a bad guy, and sure, they could have committed other crimes. But in the American justice system, you have to be proven beyond a reasonable doubt that you committed said crime.
Well,
you know what I'm saying?
Nobody said that this justice system is perfect. It's the best of everything we've got.
Oh, no, Jack,
believe me. But there are
things that happen, yeah. And it's interestingly enough, that story that she said about the guy actually being coaxed to testify using like a cue card, I kind of wonder what happens as far as follow-up with the law enforcement agencies. You know, do they follow up with those guys and say, hey, what happened here? Why did you?
But he still could have been guilty. I mean, the process did not work, all right?
That's right.
And you had someone who should not have been on the jury, all right? But he still could have been guilty. They had to look at all the evidence.
I was talking about the second one, though, where the guy testified.
Oh, sure, yeah.
But the jury, it's another one. The jury, I mean, the guy was obviously, he's probably like a drug abuser. Obviously, he was interested in the ladies, kind of the nightlife. I don't know if that makes you any less of a desirable juror. I don't know. I've done jury duty once, and I was booted.
Well,
I was booted.
Well, I was sort of invited to be for my presence to be at a jury.
Did you do it?
And I threw it away because my very good friend Don Graham.
Don't, Jack. You're not supposed to admit that stuff.
Who's been in rock and roll for many years? Says, don't worry about it. Throw it away. They got me. It took them 5 years.
Oh, so they did
get
you.
They came to my house.
Because if I did that, Jack, I would never admit it on the air, unless I was already,
No, it's all taken care of. I had to go serve.
Good, yeah, because that would be really...
They will get you. It could take 5 years, it could take 8 years, but they will eventually come and take you before a judge.
Well, and with the admission of guilt, Jack, they have evidence against you. But like you said, you took care of it, so that was not an admission of guilt. You're simply recanting... You know,
you're trying to send me... I'm going to go away for a long time.
Yeah, Ken cueing me. We got to get going here, Jack Roberts. We're running up against his break.
Don't pay attention to Ken. He's just a producer.
Hey, don't go anywhere. We're coming right back.
Michael Strahan.
Times are tough. High car repair bills are getting more expensive. Consider the fact that replacing your power steering could cost over $620.